Let me now proceed. How am I doing on time?
You're doing fine.
Okay.
How much more do you need?
I'll take what I need. Yesterday, I distributed a piece that's embargoed for release on Thursday, and it contains my more or less considered thoughts on where the election is in general and where it's going. My overall argument, I think, has an air of paradox to it. Because, I claim, and I think I'm sure this is right, that the economy will be the dominant issue in the election. I also say that the election is going to be very close, much closer than 2008, whoever wins. What that implies is that relatively small portions of the electorate for whom non-economic issues are dominant could end up making the difference. And so, for example, the white Catholics in some Midwestern states moved not so much by economic issues as by their initial and enduring response to the religious liberty controversy could end up conceivably being decisive in the electoral college. The Obama campaign would have liked to have a rerun of the 1984 Reagan campaign, which I remember on almost a minute-by-minute basis because, as some of you know, I was Walter Mondale's issues director during that campaign and the unindicted co-conspirator in the famous tax pledge. But, true story. But instead, at best, the Obama folks are going to get a rerun of 2004. I say at best, and I'll try to explain that later. So here are the key propositions that I lay out in this long document. First of all, it's going to be a very close election based on the economic indicators that I round up and a mountain of survey evidence. Secondly, the election is going to take place against a backdrop. And that is a very particular mood of the country, which is one not only of discontent with the economic present, but also deep anxiety and foreboding about the future. People think that the American dream is in peril. It's in peril for internal reasons, and it's also in peril for external reasons having to do with global competition. Everybody ought to read David's column this morning because the American people are intuitive structuralists. The American people get it that the old 20th century American success story will not be adequate for the 21st century. They get that. And one of the things that distresses them most about the current state of American politics is that they don't think that either political party gets that, right? And there's one stunning survey finding when the people are asked, do you think either political candidate has presented a clear and persuasive economic plan for the future? And the American people, and the people give Obama about 36% affirmative on that question, and Romney a few points lower. Right, so they get it. They know that whatever the success story for the 21st century may be, they're not hearing it. And they're not optimistic that they will hear it this year. And that has created a very sour mood in the country. The issues this year, economic stewardship, first and foremost. Fiscal policy turns out, when you probe, to be quite important, and it's an area of great potential weakness for the president. Taxes are actually a mid-range issue this year, not in the top tier, and it's easy to understand why. They're much lower overall. There is a tax fairness issue, which is important, but it's alloyed by something, by the suspicions of the American people. The American people strongly support the Buffett rule in principle. Then there was a very smart follow-up question, two follow-up questions, actually. Number one, what should President Obama do with the money that he raises from the Buffett rule? And you had about two-thirds of the people saying you ought to use it to reduce the deficit, and about a third saying he ought to use it to invest in the future. Then they're asked, what do you think he will do with the money? And about one-third say that he'll use it to reduce the deficit, and about two-thirds say that he'll spend it. So if they had confidence that the proceeds from the Buffett rule would actually be used the way they want, they'd be more enthusiastic about the idea of raising taxes on the wealthy than they are. The health care, which no doubt Democrats thought would be a big plus when they were pushing for it, is a big negative. But there's a big caveat there, and that is if the Supreme Court overrules some or all of the Affordable Care Act, that will set in motion a very interesting, unpredictable dynamic. And I will, I'll speculate that it might well turn out to be a mobilizer for Democrats. You know, I think it would confirm Republicans in their judgment that the bill was misguided from the start, both in policy terms and in constitutional terms. It would enrage Democrats. And, you know, from a policy standpoint, it would be an enormous blow to the Obama administration, both short-term and long-term. From a political standpoint, between now and November, we can talk about this because I'm really just speculating now. It might turn out to be, a plus. What about defense and foreign policy? This is fascinating. For more than 40 years, the Democratic Party has been on the defensive in defense and foreign policy. Not this year. So there the Obama administration, through its aggressive pursuit of the war on terror, has managed to accomplish what might be termed an historic neutralization of the defense and foreign policy issue. But apparently the Romney team hasn't gotten the message. And I can give you a very simple metric as to whether the Romney campaign is going well or badly. It's going badly whenever it talks about foreign policy. If the Romney team thinks that they're going to score any points with the American people by banging away at Obama on foreign policy, I think they're fooling themselves. We can argue about that. And there are some important foreign policy issues to debate. But I don't think Republicans should be under any illusion that they're going to make political progress by debating those issues. There are civic reasons to debate those issues. The third point I want to make about defense and foreign policy is that this issue, like so many others, has gotten caught up in the culture wars in a very interesting way. When Romney charges that Obama has gone around the country on quote-unquote apology tours, he's making essentially a cultural point about how Americans ought to think of themselves and how they ought to comport themselves. And when conservatives criticize Obama for allegedly abandoning American exceptionalism, they're making another version of that same point. Right? America is an exceptional nation. Most Republicans read John Winthrop's famous City on a Hill speech as elevating Americans above the rest of the world. I think what Winthrop really had in mind is that our flaws would be more visible, and therefore we'd better be very careful about how we behave. That's the point I think he was making, but that's not the way the speech is universally read. But foreign policy, whether foreign policy rests on exceptionalist, overtly exceptionalist foundations or not, has become part of the culture war argument in a very, very interesting way. Which leads me to another important feature of the argument that I'm making about the contemporary political scene, and that is the extraordinary, not just partisan polarization between Democrats and Republicans, but ideological polarization. It's the combination of partisanship and ideology that gives the distinctive flavor that modern American politics has. And we haven't seen anything like this. Serious political science studies tell us since the 1890s, not the 1990s, the 1890s. communities. So the sense that so many of us have that we've never seen anything like this, it's not just journalistic myopia. It's the truth. We haven't, right? We live in not unprecedented times, but at one of the four cyclical peaks of the polarization of the American party system since it was invented against the predictions and over the protests of so many founders in the 1790s. And this polarization, partisan and ideological, is one of many reasons why events have pushed both of the candidates away from the center in the past year. Obama was pushed away by the failure of the big fiscal agreement push that consumed most of 2011. Romney was pushed away by the tone and temper of the nominating contest. So that these two candidates, if you just look at their ideological positioning, present the biggest ideological gap between two presidential nominees since at least 1984. Now, that leads to the question of the role that ideology actually plays in American politics. And here I want to make just three basic points. First of all, and I have to keep on reminding my Democrat friends of this fact, there are twice as many people in the country that consider themselves conservative as consider themselves liberal. That's just a fact, a basic structural fact, and it helps to explain why Republicans can be so much more homogeneously conservative as a party than Democrats can be liberal. The second crucial fact was articulated by a couple of political scientists in the mid-1950s. Hadley Cantrill and Lloyd Free famously remarked that Americans are ideologically conservative, but operationally and programmatically, not so much. So, the classic example of that is an ideological preference for limited government, but not at the expense of cuts in Medicare. Right? So, programs pull in one direction, ideological predilections another. Now, this year, if I were asked to list three of the most significant facts about the basic structure of American politics this year, here is one of them. The average voter is ideologically closer to Romney than to Obama. But that same average voter is ideologically closer to Obama than to the Republican Party. So, right now, average voters, and this is particularly true for independents, see a lot of daylight between Mitt Romney and their perception of the Republican Party as a whole. If Romney can preserve that daylight through the general election campaign, he'll be in relatively good competitive shape. If, on the other hand, he morphs into Mr. House Republican, if his name becomes not Mitt Romney but Ryan Romney, then he's in trouble. Right? And so the tactical imperatives of the two campaigns are absolutely clear. Their mission, should they choose to accept it, is on the Romney side to preserve the gap, and on the Obama side to close it. Stay tuned. Now, there have been some, in response to the past 3 years, there have been some interesting ideological shifts. There was a surge of relative enthusiasm for more activist government in 2007 and 2008. That surge of enthusiasm crested, broke on the beach, and then pulled back substantially. And there has been a shift back towards support for a more limited and frugal government. If you ask Americans now about the fundamental goals of economic policy, what do they think is most important? You have 82% saying that growth is extremely or very important, 70% saying equal opportunity, only 46% saying narrowing the gap between of wealth and income between the rich and the rest of us. And one of the stunning findings, which both Pew and Gallup have confirmed, that there is actually less support for moves towards equalization now than there was in the late 1990s, which makes sense when you think about it, because people are always in a more generous mood when things are going well than when they're going badly. So a time when the middle class is so much under pressure is a hard time to make this argument unless you can persuade the middle class that equalization is not going to come at their expense. But that is not an easy argument to make, typically. Wending my way towards my conclusion, what kind of election is this going to be? And there are two big questions. There are two big sub-questions. First of all, is it going to be more a referendum or more a choice? One of the things that I do in my piece is to put Romney's opening general election speech side by side with Obama's opening general election speech. And it's crystal clear. The Romney campaign wants this race to be a referendum on the president's record. And you know, the president wants it to be a choice between two visions of the future. Now, let me put on my political scientist's hat for just a minute. There is a lot of political science has been committed in the past generation that tends towards the same conclusion. In elections, particularly national elections involving incumbents, the president's record is exhibit A for the electorate. And that is the default position of an incumbent election is the position of referendum rather than choice. And so the Romney campaign is going with the grain in pushing the referendum, and the Obama campaign is going against the campaign in trying to make against the grain in trying to make it into a choice. Does that mean that there are no choicey elements in the race? No. And let me try to say why with an historical example. Think back to the 1980 campaign. There was a classic two-step process of voters coming to judgment. Step number one, do we want to rehire the incumbent? In Jimmy Carter's case, the answer to that question was somewhere between no and hell no, right? depending on the pollster. But then step two came in. Is Ronald Reagan an acceptable replacement, right? Is he safe enough? Is he steady enough? Will he get us into a nuclear war, which is what the Carter campaign was charging relentlessly from June through October, et cetera? Was he this crazy, this crazy conservative? Or could we entrust the powers of the Oval Office to him? And that, and the election remained tied despite the fact that Jimmy Carter's approval rating was in the 30s until the one and only presidential debate. And the genial, avuncular Reagan who showed up was so far from the portrait of Reagan that had been painted by his adversaries that actually the expectational baseline worked very much to his advantage. And people said, gee, seems like a nice guy. Yeah, we can live with him. And, as Pat Goodell famously put it, the bottom fell out in the next 48 hours, and that was the election. So the Obama campaign is not simply wasting its time trying to preempt by making Romney unacceptable, so that even if people want to replace Obama because the economy doesn't do very well, that they will decide that they don't want to give the office to Romney. I don't think that strategy is likely to succeed, but it is, the basic structure of the situation tells you why they're trying to do it. The second key question about this presidential election, or any presidential election, is whether it's likely to focus more on persuasion or mobilization. From a recent Pew survey right at the bottom of the page, and these are the last four elections involving incumbents, and as you can see, 2012 with 23% of swing voters is shaping up to be more like 2004 than either 1996 or 1992, and what that you know, what that tells me is that the focus is going to be at least as much on mobilization of the faithful this time as in persuasion of the persuadables. Having said that, persuadables are still important, and two important facts about the election this year is that both candidates are weaker with the more centrist portions of their respective coalitions than they are with the bases of those respective coalitions. Mitt Romney's problem right now is not, repeat, not with conservatives. It's with Republicans who call themselves moderates and even liberals, which still amounts to about 30% of the of self-reported Republicans. And Obama's problems, likewise, are not with the Nancy Pelosi wing of the Democratic Party, but rather with the Steny Hoyer wing of the Democratic Party. The other thing that jumps out at me is that Obama is significantly weaker among independents, at least so far this year, than he was in 2008. In 2008, he actually carried the independent vote 52-44. A Politico survey, the Battleground survey, came out yesterday, putting him behind Romney by 10 percentage points among independents. That's not a good number. And it's exactly the same number that the ABC Washington Post survey came up with a couple of weeks ago. Independents disproportionately care about fiscal stabilization, the deficits, the debt, and they are disproportionately worried about the Brooksian structural question about the future of the American economy. So if both campaigns are smart about the independent vote, you'll be hearing more about those issues. I go through an electoral college analysis in this report. Maybe in the interest of time, I will suppress that, but I'll be happy to do a Q&A on that. Here's my bottom line for the Romney campaign. As has been the case for every single Republican candidate since the founding of the Republican Party, Ohio is a necessary condition of a Republican victory. It is a really striking fact that in the history of the Republican Party since 1856, no Republican has ever been elected president without carrying the state of Ohio. Not one. By the way, the last Democrat to do so was John Kennedy. So it's the closest thing we have to a pivotal state. In Romney's case, it's a necessary condition of victory, but hardly a sufficient condition. And that's the beginning of my electoral college analysis, and we can talk about that more, but in the interest of time, I won't. And I end with some Rumsfeldian reflections on known unknowns. That is the extent to which this presidential election, like every presidential election, takes place within a framework of contingencies that candidates can, to some extent, enumerate, but to no extent, control. And so everything that I say right now or that any of you writes tomorrow about the election is always within a frame of assumptions about contingent events. And it's always important, it seems to me, to remain open to the possibility that everything we think we now know can be turned upside down by a truly cataclysmic event. I'll give you an example. And I just picked this up this morning. As you probably heard, yesterday Netanyahu declared an early election in Israel. I woke up this morning and he had canceled those early elections, and he had actually broadened his coalition by bringing in an opposition party. So he now, I haven't had a chance to research this, but if that's correct, Netanyahu has created a national unity government, which could, I underscore could, be a prelude to a significant military action, right? I don't know that, but I think it is interesting that we now have one of the broadest based Israeli governments in history. That's usually what countries do when they're girding their loins for battle. That could be a game changer. I have no idea what the game will be after it's changed, but it could be a game changer. Stay tuned. It won't be dull.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill. Thank you very much.